Joining us in the studio is Albay Representative Congressman Edcel Lagman. Hi, sir. Good morning.
Hey, good morning, Pinky, and good morning to our viewers, particularly the overwhelming number of Catholics who are for the RH bill.
Please state a fact when you say that the Catholic vote really is pro-RH, because what I read was back in 2008, there was a 71% survey saying they are for the RH bill, but that was back in 2008.
Well, that has been consistent because in 2010, another survey was made, this time asking voters whether they would vote for RH candidate, candidates who are in favor of RH. And again, the majority said they are going to vote for candidates who support the RH bill and who have an agenda or platform on reproductive health policies.
What's majority, Congressman?
The majority was over 50%.
Okay.
And this is what is important is only 6% were against the
candidates
who would support the RH bill.
Mm-mm.
And about 20% said that it does not matter.
Yeah.
Whether they are for or against.
Okay.
Well, the best validation of this survey is the 2010 national and local elections, where practically all of the RH candidates won, including President Benigno Aquino.
Then that's, if that is the case, why is it? Why does it seem that these candidates now prefer to stay away from Congress in order to show their faces, to put a vote for the period of amendments for the RH bill? If that is the case, why would they be scared?
So it is not being scared because they know that this threat has no empirical basis. But I think the majority leader is correct. Most of them are in the respective districts because of the early filing of certificates of candidacy. You know politics. Politics is addition. You even will cabort with the devil in order to get his vote.
You work with anyone just to get a vote.
Yeah, that's correct.
So it's really, how you really see it is possibly they're just really early campaigning. That's why they'd rather be in their districts than in Congress.
But last Monday, they showed up.
Well, that's for the... Okay, let's talk about that, Congressman. Last Monday, you adopted the substitute RH bill.
Uh-huh.
Okay, that's the one we talked about when you were last here about, I'd say, 3 weeks ago.
That's correct.
That substitute RH bill, for those who may not be aware, is almost like a bill keeping the basics, principles of the RH bill.
The core.
But adding some of the...
clarifications.
Because of the critics of the RH
That's correct.
Bill. So this is supposed to be some sort of a marriage, a little bit, of the pro and anti
you may call it that way, because legislation is basically compromise, you know. And as long as you don't surrender the core or the essence of a measure, it's all right to have amendments.
Okay, so that was approved Monday.
Overwhelmingly.
What's overwhelmingly? 200?
There was no roll call vote, no nominal voting. It was a viva voce voting, but it was a thunderous yes.
All right. Then came Tuesday without a quorum.
Well, it's like this. It's very possible that some of the members who did not report for the afternoon session yesterday thought that the RH bill is already approved. So we would have to tell them no, that we have still to entertain individual amendments,
which
I think would be very few, because we've already addressed the concerns, the objections, and the reservations
of
the oppositors.
Many, there are some congressmen who said, I will debate on this word per word, line per line, paragraph per paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
And that should take long.
Well, that is always said. Most probably it's more braggadocio than anything else. And the one who said that is not even here. He's abroad presently.
Really?
I don't know whether he has been quoted again and again, despite the fact that he is not here.
Well, maybe journalists were interviewing him over the phone.
Well,
right?
It's possible. Or most probably he made email messages.
Yeah, that's right. You know, but I can't imagine, Congressman, I hope you don't mind, how the congressman thought that after Monday it was a done deal, because, I mean, they are congressmen, they know how the system works, mm-hmm. and I'm not even, you know, a lawmaker, and I know that there has to be a period of amendments, and there is that threat by some anti-RH bill proponents that they want to prolong this process. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is, you needed a quorum. I'm sure they knew
well,
that.
Well, they know that, but most probably the euphoria of having this amendment by substitution approved by the plenary caused them to possibly quote celebrate in the districts.
Tapos na.
But they're coming back. I'm sure of that.
When? Do you have a number probably today?
Either today or Monday. Definitely on Monday they will be here. And we are going to continue with the period of amendments, and hopefully within next week we will be able to vote on second reading.
Second reading, matagal-tagal pa yan.
Well, you know, in the dynamics in the in the Congress, as long as you have at least two session days, you can still approve a measure.
Please correct me if I'm wrong, sir. By Monday, you probably have about, what, 8 or 9 session days left?
It would be less than that already.
Yeah.
Let me see. About, I think, 9 session days.
Okay.
9 session days.
And that is enough for you to pass the RH bill on second reading?
That's definite. And most probably, if this is certified by the president, that would expedite the process. And we could approve it definitely before the Christmas break.
All right. So after the Christmas break comes January, I can imagine how busy you and your colleagues will be. Because even if it's not yet the official schedule for campaigning, you can imagine. I mean, for sure, certainly, these people will be in their districts campaigning already.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you are correct there, Pinky. But they will have to respond to the measure of sacrifice which they will have to give in order to enact or pass this RH bill. And I'm hopeful they will be coming back in January. And that would be most probably to ratify the bicameral conference report, just in case the Senate would approve their own version before the Christmas break.
I wonder, but what do you think? I mean, so far from your readings and probably from your talk with RH bill advocates, does it seem like you will pass it first before the Senate, or you think the Senate will be passing it earlier than you?
Does not matter, really, because if one chamber would pass it before the other, then it would be a pressure
for
the other one to do the same.
Right.
So there's no problem.
And you still have to merge.
That's correct.
Possibly.
There are could be differing provisions because of the various amendments, but that's not hard to hurdle.
But how is it that the substitute bill, how is that taken by supporters such as Senator Pia Cayetana, Senator Miriam Defensor Santiago? They're quite, they welcome that, right, the substitute bill?
That's correct. Mm-hmm. And that really put forward, very fast forward, the ARITS bill. We were able to recoup months of delay.
Let me rewind a little bit, Congressman. I remember that when they were talking about the substitute bill being brought forward to Congress at the lower house, somebody said that we shouldn't do that because actually if you do that, the length of time that will have to be focused on this will be actually longer than keeping to the original bill. But anyway, that is water under the bridge because the substitute bill, why was it that way? Why was it said that way?
Well, I think definitely it would be a faster process with the approval of the substitute bill because we don't have to individually propose the amendments coming from the committee, from the consensus in several meetings outside of the plenary, and even the amendments being proposed by the president. So it was on a package process that the amendment by substitution was approved. And this is a practice in both the Senate and in the House. And the latest example of an amendment by substitution is the syntax where the Senator Villon had That's a right. substitute bill.
That's right, sir.
So what's the problem? Mm-mm. As long as the bill is in the plenary, according to the majority floor, it's the property of the plenary, and the plenary can do anything about it.
As you please.
Well, as the majority pleases.
That's right. How about Congressman Kimmy Cuanco, Majority Floor Leader Neptali Gonzales? I know that the congresswoman had apologized, but it got to a point that on Twitter, sir, the congresswoman made her anger known because apparently she spoke to the speaker, I'm sorry, the Majority Floor Leader, and the Majority Floor Leader said, pabayaan mo na yan. Parang to the effect na hindi mo na yan papasa. Tapos sinabi po ni Congresswoman Cuanco na kung ganito lang, why were you lead? Parang, bakit parang inaano si Congressman Edcel Lagman? You're saying one thing and then doing another thing. At kung ganun lang, ayaw na lang daw niya pumasok sa politika. Kung ganun, naayos na ho ba yan?
Parang hindi sila lang nakaintindihan. Because I am certain the Majority Floor Leader is a pro-RH advocate from the very start. And he has shown that last Monday when he was able to shepherd the amendment by substitution successfully in the plenary. And they have reconciled.
Yeah.
They have reconciled. Well, they should reconcile because they belong to the same pro-RH group in the House of Representatives.
Yeah. That's fine. He shepherded the substitute RH bill. But then comes after next year. Do you think, are you actually very optimistic that this can actually be passed already, the RH bill, in its totality?
Well, I am very positive.
Yes?
I'm very positive this bill is going to be enacted into law, not in the 16th Congress, but in the 15th Congress.
This Congress, is what Congress. You're talking about.
This Congress. It has been long delayed. And it has to be delivered now. This is a long gestation for a very progressive measure.
What about church leaders, congressmen, who are saying that those who actually support the RH bill, candidates for that matter, should be punished, and that the Filipinos should not vote for them? You think that has some sort of, an effect on candidates? When you have, because some are even saying maybe they don't want to show up in Congress because they're also afraid to displease their parish priests.
But remember, Pinky, that is an old refrain. Every election, they mouth the same propaganda, and the results would show that the RH advocates win the elections. And I just would like to point out that according to Bishop Aguilias, the good bishop said that Catholics should vote for candidates who love life. That's an exact quote. And the pro-RH advocates are the ones who love life because they want to have children born who would have the better chance and opportunity of a dignified life. They would like to improve the health of mothers and reduce maternal and infant mortality and morbidity. Today, 14 mothers die daily in the Philippines. And no mother should die giving life. And then also, they would like to reduce the number of unintended and high-risk pregnancies, which are the ones principally aborted. And they would like to teach the young the correct sexual values so that teenage pregnancy would not derail their education and their life. So who loves life? Definitely the pro-RH legislators are the ones who love life.
How do you feel, though, Congressman, when you actually go to church and sometimes the priest talks about RH or sometimes you have the streamers there saying no to RH bill?
Well, we have been used to that.
You, have been you used just to turn that. A blind eye and deaf ear.
We have been used to that, and we talk to the parishioners after the services, and they tell us, don't worry, we are for our rights. And that is the result. 73% of those who go to church weekly are in favor of the RH bill. So, pumunta na sa simbahan, narinig yung hobby ng parish priest o ng pare, pero paglabas ay RH pa rin. Ang nasa isip, pro-RH pa rin.
Well, okay. Very, very, very recently I read, although we talked about it, let's just discuss it again, Congressman, briefly, that one of the, well, the difference between the old and the substitute is, I remember reading somewhere, sir, that the word universal was actually, was that adopted or was that the one removed?
Well, the original version carried the word universal access. It was changed to public access.
There you go. Okay.
Universal is the language of international commitments, international agreements. But to my mind,
isn't it the same?
It's virtually the same. And to some advocates, they even say that public is even stronger because it places on the government the onus of promoting.
The responsibility.
So, to my mind,
But if that works for them, you're like, okay, I'll change it to public.
No problem with me.
What else?
Well, they also said that we could continue, the state could continue promoting reproductive health care services and products, provided these products would not prevent the implantation of a fertilized ovum, as determined by the Food and Drugs Administration. Well, that's okay with us, because from the very start we have been saying that contraceptives have two mechanisms. One is to prevent ovulation on the part of the woman. If there is no ovulation, no egg is produced, then nothing is fertilized, then there is no fetus to be aborted. Number two, the other mechanism is to prevent the sperm from meeting the egg. So there is no fertilization. If there is no fertilization, there is no embryo. There is nothing to abort.
Right.
But if in the event that contraception fails and fertilization issues, then there should be no human intervention to prevent that implantation.
I see where you're going with that. I had an interview with Senator Pia Cayetano as well, and she really made it known in a very basic way, Congressman, and I don't know if you agree with it. I guess you would. She says that when you talk about all these abortive fashion, you're stopping life or you're aborting life for that matter, she says that everything, public access to contraceptives, whether natural or artificial, of course, for that matter, will be approved by the FDA. In other words, the FDA will not be selling anything in the market or will not approve anything in the market if it was dangerous, an abortive fashion, etc. Parang kung ano yung ibebenta ng FDA or approved ng FDA sa market will actually be the legal ones because they don't cause death of a possible child in the womb of the mother.
That's 100% correct. Because all of this would have to be licensed and approved by the Food and Drug Administration. And the United Nations and other agencies worldwide would say that contraceptives are not about the patient. And there is no law in the Philippines which would prohibit the manufacture, distribution,
sale
and use of contraceptives.
Contraceptives, right. What do you say then to those critical of the RH saying that these are abortive fashion? Do you think that they have a point? Do you think that their minds are closed? Or do you think that they're just trying to make the debates longer?
Well, all of the above. And they are misinformed. But anyway, we hope that this bill will be enacted into law. And because the experience in all countries where there had been opposition to an RH policy is that after the law is enacted, even the oppositors would now be silent and comply with the law.
All right. So you have about 9 days left. So you don't think there's going to be a quorum today? It should possibly will not be discussed today. You're looking at maybe Monday.
I'm looking at Monday.
For second reading.
Monday.
And
no, for the entertainment of individual amendments.
So if, for example, let me just hypothetically ask you, you have 20 critics who want to debate, discuss the substitute bill on RH. That will prolong the process, right?
Well, the debate is over.
I'm sorry, talk about the amendments that
well,
could possibly...
Well, that has been approved. All they have to do is to introduce their individual amendments.
Yes.
Yes. If they want to introduce amendments to the substitute bill, then they are they have the right to do
yeah.
that. But we have also the right
to reject it.
To reject it. And if we reject it, then they have 5 minutes to explain their amendment, and after that we go to a voting.
Okay, so they can have 100 amendments to the substitute bill. They can introduce that, but at the end of the day it comes down to a vote. And if you have a quorum, that amendment, if it seems incredible or out of this world for supporters, you will just thumb it down.
Well,
okay?
if the proposed individual amendments are inconsistent with the recently approved amendment by substitution, then by all means we are going to reject it.
Well,
but if
right.
they are complementary or would improve or clarify, then by all means.
You think there is still anything there, Congressman,
well,
that can improve, clarify?
You cannot possibly discount the possibility of new amendments which would enhance, perfect, or clarify the bill.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, all right. So that's a positive, probably. Number one, there's a commitment from you, always been a commitment from you, but you're looking at the 15th Congress. RH bill, according to Congressman Edcel Lagman, will be passed before the elections in May. So good luck, sir. We'll see what happens here.
Thank you.
And if I don't get to talk to you, you have a good vacation.
Well, thank you so much. But let me just underscore this. Fear or threats are destitute of reason, and they should not be allowed to deter or delay unduly the enactment of a progressive legislation. And if those bishops who say that they are opposing the RH bill is that they are basing their opposition to natural law, then I would say that threatening ang pananakot is a violation of natural law, and even a violation of the omnibus election code.
Okay. All right, Congressman Edcel Lagman, joining us here in mornings at ANC. Sir, thank you, and
thank you
good
so
luck.
Much.
Probably we'll see you again, maybe sometime next year.
Well, if this bill is approved on a second reading before the Christmas break, then I'll be happy to come back.
Okay, thank you again, Congressman Edcel Lagman.